Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Tax Talk, broadcast by the Canadian Taxpayers Federation and powered by roadkillradio.com. My name is Jordan Bateman, and I'm the British Columbia Director for the CTF, a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization dedicated to just three things: lower taxes, less waste, and more government accountability. That's what frames all the communications, research, and advocacy work we do. Thanks for joining us today. We hope this episode will educate and entertain you, inspire and even infuriate you from time to time, but most importantly, give you a bigger picture of the challenges facing our country today. If you log on to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/taxpayer.com or visit our blog at taxpayer.com/blog, you'll be able to see all of our new episodes as they come on stream, or you can download our audio podcast via iTunes. But first, today's comment of the cast. Every episode, we highlight a comment left either on our website or via social media. Last episode, I told you about Saskatchewan's public utility, SaskPower, spending $143 million to renovate its massive Regina headquarters. The CTF got a hold of the plan and made some shocking discoveries. Taxpayers were on the hook for $282,000 for a rooftop patio, $66,000 for walls with moss stuck to them, and $200,000 for kitchen equipment and a whack of other frills and gimmicks. It was canceled once our Prairie Director Colin Craig put the story out. But the response on Facebook was fast and furious. My favorite comment was a simple comment. James Plummer wrote, "A monopoly does what a monopoly can." Ain't that the truth? And that's our comment of the cast. We want to hear from you. You can check out our website at taxpayer.com or email me at bc.director@taxpayer.com. You can follow us on Twitter at taxpayer.com or myself at Jordan Bateman, or engage on our Facebook page at facebook.com/taxpayer.com. Drop us a note and you could be our comment of the cast next time. Millions of Canadians, myself included, are subscribers to the US streaming video service Netflix. We have it, we use it a ton. My little guy watches his favorite superhero cartoons. My daughters watch those tween shows that drive me crazy. My wife and I use it for documentaries, for House of Cards. All the best stuff is on Netflix. It's clearly the way television is headed. But Netflix is under attack in Canada, where goofy CRTC regulations are trying to choke it out. While Canadian companies have to collect GST and PST on streaming video, Netflix doesn't, because they're American. The CRTC is holding hearings into the whole mess, and our federal director, Gregory Thomas, has been speaking out with a simple solution that could solve this problem and level the tax playing field for Netflix's Canadian competitors. Gregory, thank you for joining us today.
Hey, it's great to be here, Jordan.
Gregory, maybe give us your impressions of the CRTC hearings on Netflix thus far.
Well, it's been a real disaster for the CRTC. The agency wanted to use this week of hearings to show that they're jumping into the 21st century, they're entering the digital age, they're coming to grips with things like Netflix and iTunes and all the great stuff you can get online. But instead, Netflix and Google showed up at the CRTC hearings and basically said, "You don't matter anymore. We get along fine with our consumers. We don't need any help from you. Just don't tax us and stay out of our business." And to the shock of the CRTC, most Canadians feel the same way.
Yeah. You mean they're not lining up to voluntarily pay for more taxes on content that you can get on the internet for free?
Well, of course, this calls into question the Canadian Media Fund tax, which is about 5% of your cable bill, which actually is a hidden tax. You don't see it on your cable bill, but what it does is it's provided almost $1 billion to Canadian content providers over the last 10 years. And there's an agency in Montreal with 100 staff that administers this huge fund. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, I'm not sure I've watched a regular Canadian series since J-Pod went off the air, the Douglas Copeland one-year CBC experiment. What's really happening here is the sands of technology have shifted. Things are moving faster than ever before, and the CRTC seems to still be stuck in the era of CB radios and disco balls. Is that fair to say? They just do not understand this kind of technology?
Well, they're trying to find a way where a 13-story office building in Gatineau, Quebec can exert influence over a nation of 35 million people and basically stop entertainment from flowing across our borders and having people watch it. They want to be able to regulate, tax, and exert influence on it. And it's just not going to happen, unfortunately. And I don't know if the CRTC has realized this, but most Canadians have moved on already.
Yeah. Now, really early on in this process, you wrote an op-ed. When the cable companies, Canadian cable companies, first came out and said, the solution here is to tax Netflix like you tax us, I think we all agree a level playing field is the best playing field. However, why are we leveling it off at higher taxes rather than finding a way to eliminate taxes on Canadian digital video production? Is that fair to say?
Yeah, I mean, we looked at how much revenue, even in 2010, federal and provincial governments across the country were only bringing in about $400 million in revenue on all kinds of media, whether it's music, movies, books. That includes books printed on paper that you buy at Chapters, for example. And it includes DVDs and CDs. Remember those? You used to go in HMV or go to the mall and buy those things. That's all the revenue the government was collecting in 2010 from any kind of media, essentially, $400 million. Well, you know, on $60 billion of tax revenue the governments collect, that's a drop in the bucket. And when you realize that they're only taxing Canadian providers, they're not taxing Netflix, they're not taxing iTunes, they're not taxing so many of the things that Canadians spend their money on for entertainment, you know, we said, why don't you just save us all a lot of hassle and drop that tax? Because it's pretty obvious that Canadians aren't going to pay it if they don't have to, and it's going to go away anyway. And that way, you know, Canadian providers, you know, if you're going to download a movie through your cable box, for example, from Shaw or Rogers or someone, you know, they could at least compete with offshore providers and maybe keep a few jobs in Canada and maybe enable the Canadian entertainment industry to continue and to compete with providers around the world.
Yeah, great point. Now, Netflix is pushing back. The CRTC at one point was actually demanding their subscriber list. Not sure how many companies in the world would willingly hand over their customer list to a government. I know we certainly wouldn't hand over our donor list to the government. Tell me about that battle. And I thought it just made the government look stupid, to be honest.
It shows you how out of touch these regulators are and how what a broad interpretation they have of their own powers to tell us what we can and cannot watch on television or over the internet. And I think they're sorely out of touch if they think they're going to have any success getting one of these offshore providers to cough up their subscriber list any more than you know, you get any organization to cough up its supporter list or its member list. You know, those things are protected by privacy rules in this country anyway.
Yeah. Now, I mean, Netflix is just one example of where technology is really straining the regulatory schemes that virtually every level of government puts into place. Here in Vancouver, we have Uber, the car sharing service, was actually chased out of Vancouver thanks to, most people believe, a powerful taxi lobby. They've just come back, reapplied, trying to do things the right way to get into the market. And now the Vancouver City Council said, no, we don't want to talk about it for 6 months. Come back to us after the election. Uber, Lyft, Airbnb, the private hotel kind of system where you can go to another city and stay with a private residence. There's even a restaurant service now where, you know, Gregory, if you're an excellent chef, I can book to eat at your home and you'll cook me a lovely dinner and I'll pay you $30 for the pleasure of your company. Governments just are not able to respond to this as quickly as they should. How do we balance it? I mean, how do we make sure that we're still keeping, you know, the regulations as far as public safety and all those important things in place while still trying to reflect what the marketplace is doing?
Well, I think we have to push for freedom and free markets and free trade. I mean, you know, the taxi situation in Vancouver is a tremendous example. You know, it's just about impossible to get a taxi anytime when you need a taxi in Vancouver. It's bad for tourism. It gives the city a bad image. And, you know, essentially the city council is so mobbed up with donors and interest groups that are relating to the taxi industry, they're blocking anyone who can provide transportation from coming in and competing. And as a result, and we've seen this all over the world, a taxi license, a taxi medallion, becomes an asset that you can trade because it's a chunk of the market that is worth tens or, you know, in some cities, hundreds of thousands of dollars that says, hey, this is the only person who can drive a car around the city and charge people money to take them from place to place. You know, it's 18th century thinking in the 21st century, and let's hope that Uber and its allies and consumers, you know, push back against these politicians and get rid of these licensing schemes that just favor insiders.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, the bottom line here is the market is speaking with their pocketbook, and that's virtually impossible for governments to ignore. Gregory, last question. If Frank Underwood was running Canada or was running Netflix, what would Frank Underwood say to the CRTC?
I think Frank Underwood would just invite CRTC down to have a nice meeting in an underground subway station, and he'd sort it out in a big hurry.
Yeah, so come see me in the subway station. There's no problems there. Gregory, great work as always. Thank you for monitoring this. As a Netflix user, any excuse I have to avoid paying tax on that service, I am going to appreciate. So thanks for your work on that.
Thanks, Jordan.
If you want to keep tabs on Gregory, follow him on Twitter, @GThomasCTF. And now it's time for Waste of the Week, an example of how government is wasting your hard-earned tax dollars. This time we go to Ottawa, where a big federal government union, PSAC, represents thousands and thousands of federal government workers while they're grinding out new contracts. And they're asking for the moon. In fact, they're asking for three new statutory holidays. January 2nd, just in case you were still hungover from January 1st when you were hungover from New Year's Eve. February 16th, 2 days after Valentine's Day. I guess they want to extend the love fest. And May 1st, which of course is National Union Day. Folks, I can't make this up. They're also asking for new hires. Day one, you arrive in Ottawa to go to work. You should be given 4 weeks of paid vacation, up from 3 weeks. Hard to believe that we're punishing our federal bureaucrats with only 3 weeks the first year they work for us. And most appallingly, one of the groups, the Educational and Library Science Group, has demanded that we add an, quote, Aboriginal spirit friend to the definition of family for the purposes of grieving. So federal government employees get a couple weeks off if a loved one passes away, rightfully so, immediate family, a son, a daughter, a father, a mother, a spouse. If they pass away, I think we all agree bereavement leave, that's, you know, well within their rights to have. But now they want to add an Aboriginal spirit friend to that. Now, as far as we could tell, they invented this term. We Googled it. There were no Aboriginal spirit friend results. Until, of course, we got a hold of the story. Now there's plenty of Aboriginal spirit friend discussion. As far as we can tell, it appears to be a code for imaginary friends. Even First Nations officials told us and the media that they've never heard of this term and didn't quibble with our description of it as an imaginary friend. So folks, if your imaginary friend is ill, if your imaginary friend is on their deathbed, now's the time to go work for the federal government, because you may be getting a 2 weeks leave if they pass away. We just can't make this stuff up. That's our waste of the week. That's it for this episode of Tax Talk from the Canadian Taxpayers Federation. If you want to follow me on Twitter, you can, @JordanBateman, or follow the CTF on Twitter, @taxpayer.com. You can email me, bc.director@taxpayer.com, or check out our website, @taxpayer.com, or our Facebook page. Tons of great stuff going up there every single day. Facebook.com/taxpayer.com. Thank you for tuning in. And until next week, I'm Jordan Bateman, asking you to remember this quote from George Allen. Quote, "We should favor innovation and freedom over regulation." Take care, everyone.